Good evening, welcome to the November 18th, 2014 Planning Board meeting. If you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. A couple of things. First off, Roseanne is ill this evening. She will not be here. And Dan Wright is upstairs at the joint committee meeting. He will be down when that adjourns, I take it. First on the agenda is public comments. Are there any public comments on any non-agenda items? Hearing none, we will close the public comments at 7:01. Next is a review and approval of minutes from the October 14th meeting. Is there a motion?
I'll make the motion to approve the minutes of October 14th, 2014.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Comments? Concerns? Hearing none? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. All those opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you. On to our first piece of regular business. It's Acadia Engineers and Constructors LLC, public hearing for an application for modification of a site plan at 13 and 15 Water Street, tax map U3, lot 4 in the M2 zone. The proposal is to modify and approve site plan for a mixed-use development at 13 and 15 Water Street that was approved by the Planning Board and signed by the Planning Board Chairman on July 19, 2013. The project involves the restoration and renovation of the F.E. Lang Blacksmith Building and construction of 4 new townhome units. Modifications include landscaping, curbing, stormwater management and drainage, signage, lighting, elimination of waste and recycling area, and siting of above-ground propane fuel tank. Before I open it up with Mr. Nichols, does everybody have the letter and the responses from our review engineer? Site inspection engineer, manual engineering. I think this is probably key if everybody has that.
It's dated August 5th?
Yes, it was from the last meeting. It's dated August 5th.
Yeah.
Everybody has that? Great.
Sure.
Okay, Tim White.
I'm just going to recuse myself.
Oh, yes. Yes. Okay. So, Mr. Nichols, why don't you give us a brief just rundown of what has changed? Well, we also have a site plan, an existing condition site plan, or as-built that was done by Doucette. At this point, I don't want to go point by point. Just want to just give us the general modifications, and then we can ask questions and talk and whatever.
Sure.
All right.
Sure. So, the phase one in terms of site work is substantially complete. We recently paved the driveway, put down the base course for the winter. The top course will be completed in the spring. And we didn't want to put the top course on because we still have some work to do on the driveway or from the driveway. Drainage structures have been installed. We added a third infiltration drainage basin. The cistern has been, the underground cistern has been installed. Curbing has been installed along the front of the blacksmith shop, granite curbing. And granite curbing and edging has been installed at the end of the driveway along the Rivermore property, approximately 60 linear feet of granite curbing.
Okay, thank you. From my recollection of, you know, a site walk this past fall or late summer, there were several issues, the biggest of which was the seashells as opposed to the paving, which has now been rectified. I think as Mr. Nichols just said, there's been a lot of other minor modifications, you know, some drainage added. Diane, would you fill us in on what the town DPW director has to say about the signage and whatnot?
Yeah. I do want to mention that in the discussions with Tim and the modifications to the drainage,
We did ask him to provide us with a drainage statement from his engineer, and he provided that to us, and he also gave us some specifications on the new catch basin design, and those were reviewed internally, and they were approved administratively. And with that, we gave Mr. Nichols the go-ahead, if you will, with the, so he could do the paving work. I'm glad to hear that that's done and the drainage is in. Fantastic. I did, there were a couple of issues that we wanted to get some feedback from Rick Malosky on, and the first one had to do with the specific site drainage, site signage. If you recall, in the original plan, there was a proposal to have signage every, I don't know, it's like 50 feet maybe, to identify where the fire lane was, and Mr. Nichols felt that that was excessive, and so he has proposed to have signage to the driveway, at the driveway to the property, and also there are provisions in the condo documents that Mr. Nichols provided us with concerning parking restrictions and fire lane clearance requirements, which are very detailed, and I think they're in keeping with the spirit of what the planning board was trying to achieve by, you know, requiring the posting of those signs. The second item that we wanted feedback from Rick on was the, there's a above ground fuel cylinder, LP fuel cylinder, located at the northeasternmost corner of the property, and Rick reviewed that, and he was in agreement with, as it is, there wasn't a need for additional ball protection in that area. And I received a memo from him today indicating that he had met with Mr. Nichols, they did a site walk of all the changes, and that he was in agreement with the changes as proposed and as shown on the site plan.
Okay. Thank you. Unless somebody wants to go point by point through this list, does anybody have any concerns? I think I was out there, took a ride out there this past week. I think the site looks good. The changes, I think, that have been made, if they were on the plan originally, we would have approved it. I mean, I think the big issue we had, obviously, was the seashells versus the paving. So for what it's worth, I'm good with what we have in front of us, and I'm good to accept it. Does anybody else have any comments? I need to open it up to the public if the public has any comments, but any planning board members, any questions or comments, concerns?
Well, what we're actually deliberating on will be the amended plan.
Correct.
To accept this.
Correct.
I did have one further report. I did receive a phone call from Rob Phillips, who is, I believe he's the chairman of the Rivermore Board of Directors, and he explained to me that Rivermore Landing was in agreement with the revised landscaping plan. At one point, there was discussion about maybe having some landscaping along his property, or their property, excuse me. And Mr. Nichols has removed some invasive Norway species, Norway maples, which are invasive species. And overall, everyone is pleased with the modifications that were made to the landscaping. And he indicated that they were in agreement with the revised plan.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions for Mr. Nichols? If not, is there anybody in the audience who would like to speak on this subject? Speak now? No? Okay. So what's the pleasure of the board? Then we in favor of approving the amended site plan? If nobody has any comments or questions or concerns, I'll entertain a motion.
I move that we accept the amended site plan for the applicant at Lang's War Townhomes, 13 Water Street, Newmarket, as presented tonight.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? 5-0, it passes. Thank you, Mr. Nichols.
Thank you.
Good luck going forward.
Thank you.
All righty. Welcome back. All right, next on the agenda is NIP Lot 6 LLC, Shearwater Investment Corp., continuation of a public hearing for an application for major site plan review at 2 Forbes Road, NIP Lot 6 LLC, tax map R3, Lot 9-6, and 181 Exeter Road, Shearwater Investment Corp., tax map R3, Lot 8, both in the B2 zone. The proposal is for a 24,000-square-foot expansion of the existing industrial building located at 2 Forbes Road with associated parking, drainage, and landscaping improvements. Pending site plan approval, the lots will be merged to make one lot. Welcome.
Good evening. I'm Joe Pacino from Ty and Bond, as you may remember from the last meeting, which was way back in July. I think we've been here actually since January. But I just wanted to give an update tonight on where we're at. We met with the TRC on November 6th and pretty much just wrapped up the outstanding items at that meeting besides the DOT permit, which is still kind of outstanding. We're still working through that with the DOT. They've requested us to do some additional survey out there to look at some site distances. We've agreed to do that. We're getting the survey done now. And we're hoping to have that wrapped up for the next meeting and gain approval in December. So with that, I can just kind of open it up to questions. I mean, it's pretty.
There's been no changes to the site plan since our last meeting,
basically. Oh, excuse me. Sorry. Yes, there has been a change to the site plan.
Okay.
Basically, we revised the site plan to reflect the recommendations from the geotech report that was done and that was approved by the DOT. So that changes the slope from a previously grassed 1.5-to-1 slope to a riprap 1.5-to-1 slope now, which is based on the DOT recommendations and approval of the geotech study.
Okay.
So that's the only change.
And you're working on, like I said, survey for the intersection?
Currently working on the survey. Yep, exactly.
For the access permit.
We'll take a look at that. We'll hopefully address those comments from DOT, and then I think that should be it.
We're hoping that the TRC will meet again to look at the plan once we get the additional data from them, and DOT wanted to be part of that meeting as well.
Perfect. Yeah, that'd be great.
And hopefully we can do that before December 8th, which is our next meeting. Joe, can I ask you a question? Did you provide us with a request for continuation? Because I think we had discussed that.
For this meeting?
For the next, to extend this to the next meeting. And I didn't.
It's my job, and I forgot all about it.
Okay.
Okay.
You can ask tonight if you want. If you so choose, you can ask.
If you would ask for tonight, and we have that in the public record.
It would be great if we can.
And the board can vote on that.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Is there anybody from the public here to speak about this? Okay, no. What's the board? Obviously, we need to continue this. Does anybody have any questions, concerns, any looking for any additional information or?
Did we decide that you could see the riprap from the road?
We're still making.
Is that going to be like a landscaped kind of barrier that so we don't have to look?
That's right. We still are trying to maintain that landscape buffer that we previously proposed, so that really hasn't changed. The riprap's going to be on the opposite side of Route 108, so you won't really be able to see it directly from Route 108.
And that's being requested by the state?
So, I can kind of back up. So, the recommendation from the planning board was to go to the DOT to get approval for the slope, and then the DOT came back and said, we'd like to do a geotech report. We did it in study, so we did a geotech study, which found some different soils out there. And they came back and said, well, based on the soils that we found, different than what was assumed, we think riprap slope versus what was previously proposed.
What kind of soils were you, what were you expecting and what did you find?
We were expecting more of a gravelly, consistent subsoil, and it was a little bit different layers than what was out there, yep.
And DOT was concerned because they're concerned about the stability of 108.
Exactly.
That's why they got involved.
Yep, so we had a review, and then that's where we ended up.
So were they more sandy, and you were kind of hoping for?
Yeah, there was just multiple layers.
Gravel.
I can just say it was just a little bit sandy. There was multiple layers through the 60 feet of the fill below it.
So if somebody would ask for a continuance, we could.
I'd be happy to ask for a continuance until the next meeting. Just would like to ask one more time if there's anything else that is outstanding we can look at so we can come prepared to wrap it up next meeting.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why I asked the question. Waiting for anything additional.
Excellent.
Know if anybody else
sounds
is.
Sounds good. So. Then we would, request a continuation until the December 8th meeting.
December 9th.
December 9th.
Oh, December 9th. Excuse me.
Yeah, December 9th, sorry.
Make a motion, we continue the application until the December 9th meeting.
Is there?
Shearwater Investments.
Second.
Motion's. Okay, motion's made and seconded.
Second, sorry.
Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And I just want to say, I've been on the TRC committee meetings, and this company has worked with us all the way.
Yep.
I was very pleased, even though we may have different opinions on it, they've always worked with us. So I think that's very important to let the community know.
Well, thank you very much. We appreciate that.
Thank you. See you next month.
Yeah, bye-bye.
All righty, onward. Third on the list is Hayden Family Revocable Trust, Mark L. and Karen S. Hayden, trustees, Chinburg Builders, Inc. Continuation of a public hearing for an application for subdivision related to a 10-lot residential open space design development at 74 Ball Hill Road, tax map R7, lot 24 in the R1 zone. Proposed development involves the construction of single-family homes on a small cul-de-sac and the preservation of 21.09 acres as open space on a parcel of approximately 36 acres. Good evening, Mr. Smith and Mr. Asia.
Good evening, Chairman Bodiman, members of the board.
So I guess to refresh everybody's memory, we were waiting for confirmation of as to how the open space was going to be handled and managed. We have a letter from the 14th from Matt Asia from Chinburg Builders, kind of outlining that Southeastern Land Trust is going to maintain the property. With that, I'll open it up to Mr. Smith to fill us in.
Thank you. Yes, and I guess I'll precede this by mentioning I don't think we had this in hand. The last time we were before you, we do have a letter stating that we have satisfactorily addressed all prior comments from Underwood Engineers. And I believe we've addressed everything from TRC aside from the open space piece. As you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, it appears Chinburg Builders has come to a conclusive agreement that Southeast Land Trust will be the stewards of the property. They will hold the easement and do the annual maintenance and stewardship. But based on that, Chinburg Builders had not gotten the actual management plan together. And the reason being is because when it became evident that it may not be the Conservation Commission, it may be Southeast Land Trust, they have their own documents that they like to use, so Chinburg wasn't going to reinvent the wheel there. And really, the only thing that would be different than most of Southeast Land Trust's management plans for this is the owner's desire to continue to allow the pedestrian ATV and in the winter the motorized snowmobile traffic, as we have discussed on the trails that he maintains out there. So that will be forthcoming. That agreement just came through on the 14th, with the Southeast Land Trust. So monies will have to be exchanged and all of that prior to us getting an actual management plan out of them. But certainly I don't think, that there's anything in the board's purview, unless you have specific line items that you'd like to see specifically addressed in that management plan. But it appears we could potentially be in a position for a conditional approval pending final approval of that document by Conservation Commission and planning staff.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions?
I do have a question.
Sure.
The Conservation Commission had expressed an interest in who would be paying for the signs that would delineate the land as conservation land. Is that something that you can take care of as a condition of the approval, or is that something that
management plan?
Yeah, I think that was already agreed to by Chinburg Builders at previous hearings.
So they will install the signs and maintain them into perpetuity?
Well, I think once it's turned over, the homeowners association will maintain them in perpetuity.
Okay.
But yes, initially they will be part of the actual road construction.
Install the signs and buy the signs and put the signs in.
That's right.
Make them look nice. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Does anybody else have any questions? Diane, do you want to fill us in from your perspective where we are?
Yeah, just as part of one of the conditions on the special use permit was that there'd be a management plan that would be developed by a professional that would address things such as protection of some of the significant trees on the property. Ms. Sheldon, I think you were concerned about those. Also, protection of some of the views from the top, and to be sure that there would be continuing public access And I got the impression from the Conservation Commission that they wanted to be part of those discussions with the land trust. And so I thought it would be advantageous if we could have a technical review meeting, if you will, with our Conservation Commission representatives and Dwayne Hyde, who's with the land trust.
Once they've got that actual document together.
A better understanding from them specifically how they would be managing the property in the future. Because I think that was a really critical piece of this overall approval. So that's why I'm recommending that we hold off on a conditional approval tonight until we can have that discussion and make sure everybody's on the same page, and so that we can move forward with a conditional approval at the next meeting. That would be my suggestion.
And I guess in rebuttal to that, Diane, I would just say that I've read a number of Southeast Land Trust management plans for different properties and other clients of mine. And with regard to the management and the preservation of trees, there is no allowance in any of them that I've seen, except for perhaps one that was targeted for forestry. But to harvest anything out of there that is not dead or diseased or a threat to the public. And I believe that's how this is intended to be written. And again, I mean, we're happy to go ahead and have the TRC include Dwayne Hyde or whomever else from Southeast Land Trust with members of the Conservation Commission. But I think a report back from staff should probably be sufficient for this board. Just trying to shorten your agenda.
Couldn't we make one of the conditions of the approval acceptance by the board of the management plan?
Yep.
Absolutely.
Absolutely could.
Yeah.
And
Yeah.
Coming back for a whole
other
hearing on the application. So.
We all agree that the only outstanding issue is the management plan.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, so I agree with, Val. I have no issue then an approval subject to an acceptable management plan being agreed to by us in the Conservation Commission, whoever needs to.
It's also, we do have standard conditions on all subdivision approvals that, there's a road bond that's posted, that there's construction inspections and a developer's agreement.
Yeah.
And
in
this case, there are no state permits that I'm aware of. So,
and I think,
so long as it's understood, those items will be part of the developer's agreement.
Absolutely. And I believe we've already gotten the number agreed to by Underwood, but I'm not going to say that with 100% certainty. I know that we've put together road bond estimate, and I thought we had gotten that squared away, but I will double check on that tomorrow.
I don't remember seeing it.
Okay,
on
and
that.
So it, I may be. That may not have gotten submitted to Underwood at this point.
Okay, so long as we can work together internally to get those things resolved, I'm fine with that.
Okay, so what's the pleasure of the board? Anybody want to make a motion?
I just want to be clear, there's no additional conditions of approval. Those have all been worked out on the plan with the TRC. I'll make a motion to approve the Hayden Family Rockwell Trust and Mark Allen Karras Hayden Trustees and Chinburg Builders for the subdivision of 10 residential open space design development, 10 lot subdivision, a residential open space design development, 74 Ballfield Road on tax map R7, lot 24 in the R1 zone.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
So where is this going now? We're still waiting on
Excuse me. Subject to the condition of the additional condition.
Management plan.
Of the management plan.
Accept the management plan. Thank you.
Following review by staff and the Conservation Commission, something like that.
Okay.
I just want to make sure they're involved in the process.
Sure.
Second.
So is that clear?
Yeah.
It includes the management.
I'll second again.
Any further discussion, comments, concerns? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Congratulations.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
And again, they were another organization that worked very well with the planning board.
Good.
And it's nice to have.
We're just so easy to get along with.
No, it's nice to have that good bond between the planning board and the builders and everyone working together.
Thank you very much. All righty, fourth on our
hit list.
Newmarket Housing Authority, Newmarket Town Solar LLC, continuation of a public hearing for an application for a minor site plan review at 34 Gordon Avenue, tax map U4, Lot 8, in the M3 zone. The proposal is to allow for a community solar array to be built on the grounds of the Newmarket Housing Authority to provide discounted electricity to the tenants in the complex. The system is a low-profile project that will have no safety or health concerns and provides no view, smell, or sound concerns for the surrounding community. Welcome.
Thanks for having me back.
No problem. I think the way we left it off at the last meeting, there were three or four issues that we wanted to have addressed.
Yep.
And I've gone through the information. I think you've provided it all to us, but would you walk us through
Absolutely.
The various components of it, please?
No problem. So thank you to the board for having us back. There was...
Can I interrupt you for 1 second? Would you say your name? And
oh, yeah, sorry. Of course. Andrew Keller from New Hampshire Solar Garden. There were about a half a dozen things that I think needed to be addressed, and we wanted to make sure that we did our best in a relatively short order to get as much information back to the board, just so everybody was comfortable with some of the concerns initially. The first one, and I would say the larger issue, was the age of the plan. Dating back well over 10 years, and the topo, and could there have been any changes to that site? So what we were coming to the board asking for is technically a waiver for having topo on the site plan, because what we were able to do is we were able to go back to the local survey company who did some topo work on it 3 years ago, because we had a limited amount of time, and we had it was hard to get field workers out there to get to do an actual field work, but having a plan that was 3 years old and having a memo written by this local firm to verify that there haven't been any changes physically since then is part of the reason we were asking for a formal waiver and asking the board's permission to utilize the site plan as it is now with those updated topo information from about three years ago. I think that was the biggest component here.
Yep.
Some of the other items, we wanted to have some more clarity for where the actual fence was going to be around the solar garden, which is identified in the plan for you there. We wanted to ensure that the path, while it's not a public path, you know, it's the pleasure of the property owner to continue to allow people to go through from the neighborhood over to the community center, so we wanted to make sure that was clear and that the solar garden was not going to impede on that walking space. So the good news is that the field work that was done 3 years ago had defined where that path was. We were able to pick that up on the plan and show that pretty clearly as well. The next item on hand was issues related to the height of the panels. You know, and it wasn't clearly identified in the secondary pages of the plan that you have to just show the range that we discussed last time, which was about, you know, could be in the range of 4 to 6 feet at the high end, at the top of the actual panels themselves. So we wanted to make that clear, give you a cross-section, what that looked like. Also, there was just some question about the spacing in between the panels. And also, we picked that up in the main plan there. There's a small reference to the 9-inch gap that we referred to in the last discussion as well, to make that clear to the board. And finally, you know, there was discussion about drainage, how it's going to impact the drainage. One thing that we stated the last time we were here is that, you know, we have no intention of changing the surface underneath it. We're going to continue to have grass. There'll be pile-driven posts that will be driven down into the soil. And we had our engineer write a memo to you folks so you could understand their perspective of how we would or would not impact drainage into the brook. Obviously, that's, you know, 100-plus feet away. And it was the opinion of our engineer that there would be no increased concerns related to having those solar panels there and you know, using the existing vegetation there to keep things moving the way they always have. We would be in a good place without impacting any additional drainage. So I think with all that being said, we have, you know, the letter from myself asking for the waiver. We have the memo from the survey crew. You obviously have the updated plan, and there's also a memo there from our engineer regarding the drainage. So I feel as though that picked up almost all the items that were in the minutes from last time. Any other questions or concerns? Happy to answer.
Just go ahead, one slight concern. Are the panels coated with any kind of anti-reflective coating, or do they reflect? I know it's mentioned that they face southward. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious if they're going to blind somebody in their bedroom. You know what I mean?
No. The solar panels are meant to absorb, not to reflect.
Well, I realize that, yeah. But at the same time, I mean, I didn't go as deep into the website that you had mentioned last time. That's probably my fault, but just want to check in on the reflectivity of those panels.
There is a slight chance, just like any window, like if you walk by, you know, a car at the right point, the right time, yes, there might be a little bit of reflectivity. There might be a little bit off the edges of the metal, but these are not meant to reflect. These type of panels are being installed at airports, where we have one in our own state that caused a lot of issues. But no, these panels are meant to absorb all of the refraction. We don't want to be sending any other light in any other directions. And the angle of where they are versus anybody in the area, there'll be no concerns of any type of reflectivity. And then on the north side, you don't have any issues with reflection because we have a nice a buffer of trees and fence as well. And you won't have any light hitting on the back side of the panels.
Thank you. John, do you have any?
No, I'm good. This is one observation.
Yeah.
You know, I see where you outlined your chain link fence around there.
Mm-hmm.
And the housing at the, what is it, the is it the southerly end, where the housing is? Is there any existing fence there?
There sure is.
Is there any, I mean, it seems like there's going to be a lot of fence there, just so from a purely aesthetic point of view. I'm just wondering, is there any reason you just didn't tie into that existing fence and save yourself another whole row of fence?
We are. Yeah, we are going to. That's what we discussed the last meeting, is the plan. We showed it attaching to where that existing fence is,
oh,
that chain link fence.
It looked like there was two fences there, so.
It should not be. I mean, if it picked up that way.
Yeah, it does show that.
Okay.
You're going to continue that and just tie into the existing
absolutely.
Fence.
I mean, I appreciate the observation. It would be excessive to do that. But yes, we want to keep it look consistent.
One of the neighbors had also just mentioned the view and everything else, and when I walked around the site, I noticed that, you know, it is planted there, and I guess that's up to the housing authority. They have, you know, shrubbery that obviously wouldn't grow so high that it
correct.
Blocks the sun out from your
right.
panels. But I'm just wondering, was that part of the plan at all?
So
any kind of planting there, just to sort of, or not?
On which side of the of the
array? All along the row of where the housing is.
No.
Most of that had sort of a row of hedge there, except right in front of the panels. Was there any plan to extend that?
No, I mean, it's the property owner's decision. If they want it, it was part of the lease discussions,
yeah.
and they understand that as part of the lease language, they can't impede on the ability for the sun to hit the panel. So adding some additional vegetation there wasn't, they didn't have any interest, they didn't have any need to, they weren't asking us to do it. So,
right.
you know, we try not to do that because that can become a long-term operations and maintenance issue that we'd like to not have to deal with. If there was, like, you know, I think one of the concerns that we addressed with Diane early on was, you know, as it relates to the community center side.
Right.
And as you can see by where the array has been placed, because of where the drainage underneath the ground was placed, we had to kind of work within the area we could work, which happened to push us away from that kind of buffer going towards that
right.
direction. And then having the fence and some of the vegetation on the side of the neighborhood, again, there too will take your attention and the view shed issues away.
Okay. Anything else, Peter?
No. Nope.
Jane?
Yeah, just one quick thing. So I would tend to think that this type of service, we'll call it,
mm-hmm.
Is something that's constantly evolving, correct?
Yeah, sure. Like, what do you mean by evolving?
So the type of panel may change. And I guess what I'm trying to understand is just what would be the short-term maintenance for
mm-hmm.
it as opposed to the long-term life cycle management
sure.
of it?
Got it. I follow you. Solar panels are definitely evolving. I mean, this technology is evolving. The evolution of our industry is happening in half a percentage points
mm-hmm.
from an efficiency standpoint, from ways to make these panels better, bigger, faster. You know, what we've found to date is that most of the panels have reached a maximum amount of physical space that we can use up for the amount of energy you can produce. You can make a bigger panel. I mean, you can build a panel the size of this room if you want to, but it's going to take a crane to move it. So
right.
we've gotten to the point where one or two people could install a given panel on a given racking system. So we've kind of maxed out the footprint. So bigger isn't necessarily going to, it's not like the computer industry where the minute you buy it, it's already, you know, obsolete because they're evolving.
Mm-hmm.
It's not evolving that quickly.
Mm-hmm.
As far as operations and maintenance, this technology comes with 25-year warranties on the panels and the inverters, the two major components that could break or have failure issues. So short-term maintenance is minimal. I mean, these are very simple systems. It's in our best interest, I think we discussed this the last meeting, was that if there was soiling of the panels, a flock of birds came through and decided to call it home for a couple of days, we got to keep an eye on that. And we have the ability to monitor the output of the array remotely. So if there was a beautiful June and we're not producing the power that we know we should produce in June, you know, we're going to know by data. But we're also more than likely, because of the nature of the location too, also have a camera on it so we can visually see it as well. But part of our regular operations and maintenance is to check on them periodically, seasonally. I mean, there are some trees around. After a storm, we might want to go poke around. Or again, we have a good relationship with the property owner, so their maintenance folks can keep an eye on things for us. If something is concerning, we can send out our electrician to take a look at it. But if anything goes wrong electrically with the mm-hmm. system, we'll get a notification, email, text alert as part of the way we kind of build these systems.
So you're not seeing any type of technology replacement?
No. No. I mean, as the owner of the system, if it got to a point in 15 years from now where there was something miraculous that came up that we can't conceive of today that would make it a better, faster mousetrap, mm-hmm. We would have to analyze it from the perspective we just spent all the money and incurred all the benefit over the last 15 years, that if on day one of year 16, the benefit would outweigh the last 15 years. So a lot of these systems, even systems that have been in the market for 10 or 12 years even now under this type of a model, it's unlikely that you would even ever change out a system that might even be half the size because you've incurred all that benefit over the last 10 years.
Okay. So. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Janice?
Following along with Jane, after the 25-year warranty yep. period kicks away,
yep.
who's going to be responsible for maintaining it?
So we have a lease structure in place with the property owner where we have a 20-year lease with 2 5-year extensions. At the end of the year, at the end of the lease period, we have language in the lease that requires us to remove the equipment and put the property back to the way it was. This system, just like your refrigerator, you go out of warranty, it doesn't mean it breaks on the next day necessarily. I mean,
yeah,
they can.
But what happens, you're saying to remove it.
They take it apart. Down.
But why would you want to take it apart? If they're getting solar energy from
you probably wouldn't.
You would just continue it?
Yeah, I mean, okay. We have the basis of the language of this type of structure. It's comfortable for landowners. We wouldn't want to say, give us a 100-year lease.
Oh, okay.
No, we would sign that. So
after you put it all
no,
in, it's working well for everyone.
Absolutely. Because after 15 years, we've paid like the mortgage on it. Like we take out some debt on it. So the second half of the green contract is usually where we make more of our profit in the project. It's in everybody's best interest to continue because I think most people would agree that power rates in 25 years are going to be more than today, most likely. So why would you? You wouldn't just take it down if it's working. You would take it down and maybe upgrade it to a different panel at that point because you've kind of used the life of that, and then maybe it makes sense to upgrade.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Val?
I have no questions for the applicant.
Okay. What's the pleasure of the board? Go ahead.
We had just a recommendation for conditions that the plans be stamped. The first one, which is the survey prepared by Doucette Survey. Would that be stamped by the licensed surveyor, and also that the other two sheets, 2 and 3, be stamped by the professional engineer who designed the plans?
Okay.
That would be the recommendation for approval.
No. We're in the public portion still. Is there anybody in the public that would like to speak to this subject? Okay. Hearing none, we will close the public hearing. 7:38 and onward. So there is one waiver request, which is for the survey, which I'm much happier with the 2011 survey and a letter from Bill Doucette saying it's the same as it was back then. So is there a motion? Oh, go ahead, Val.
I brought it up at the last meeting. I'm still struggling with the issue of the zoning, whether or not how this fits into a permitted use in the M3 zone.
Okay.
We understand from the discussion at the last meeting that this is a commercial enterprise because they're leasing the property. And we understand, yes, that the tenants, if you will, are getting benefit from this. But under the purview of the planning board, does this meet the permitted use in the M3 zone? And how does that fit in? Because we're not just making a decision here that this is for the Newmarket Housing Authority development. Does this apply to anyone who is in the M3 zone or other zones that also don't see this as any kind of permitted use. And I mean, you can use a multitude of examples. Don't get me wrong, I think this is a great application for that, the use of this site, you know, within this location, and the benefits are obvious. But I'm coming back to, do we have the authority over this under the, as a permitted use in the M3 zone?
I thought we decided at the last meeting that it was a mixed use.
Right, it is.
Because.
But then where it fits in, single family, multifamily, age restricted, residential care, daycare, bed and breakfast.
It should be a mixed use category at the bottom of the list.
And then forestry.
Isn't there a mixed use category at the bottom of the list?
Again, I'm looking for that clarification. Because it's under the, and then further under the zoning, it's defining mixed use as a mix of non-residential and commercial uses within the zones. But the only commercial use I see here is a studio.
Oh, the only specific one listed?
The only specific commercial use.
Let me look at the table then.
You know, or a daycare would be, you know, fall under that as a mixed use. So that's what I'm struggling with from a zoning perspective and our authority to actually approve this.
This is a M3 district?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. And under section 7.02 are the requirements for mixed-use developments. So let's go to section 7.02. Mixing of multiple non-residential uses on a lot. That's not what we're talking about. A mix of residential and non-residential uses on one lot permitted in the following districts, the M3 district. And the requirement for that is site plan approval by the planning board.
We'll read up on B first. In certain instances, it is appropriate to have a mix of permitted uses on a single lot. Residential use may be permitted in combination with non-residential uses on a single lot or in a single structure, provided the following are met. It still states within that paragraph, it's a mix of permitted uses.
And this is a permitted use?
Where? Under M3.
It's a mixed use.
So I could have a manufacturing on that lot in the M3 zone?
It's very vague. It says it can be a non-residential use.
Of a permitted use. And if you go to the table of permitted uses, I don't see where we can fit it in, of what's permitted in that district, in that zone.
It's way over my head.
No, I mean, I would classify it as a mixed use for purposes of this application.
I agree it's a mixed use.
But you're saying that,
are they
manufacturing? You're determining that, but you're saying that it has to be a permitted use within that zone.
That's how I read it.
Okay.
We're manufacturing electricity, would that be safe to say? So if we're in the M2 zone, that would be permitted.
I wouldn't say manufacturing.
Well, it's a production.
Well, is that light?
That's a good question. Are you manufacturing electricity? I mean,
sure you are.
You are general.
Well, are you?
I mean, to manufacture something, you take different parts, and isn't that under the?
Well, how do we? Let's look in the definition of light manufacturing.
But it's not. It doesn't matter because it's not allowed in the M3. There's only 7 distinct permitted uses in the M3 zone.
Am I not looking in the right place? It's an interpretation question.
Mm-hmm.
So is the concern just that you're setting a precedent to?
Oh, major.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, anything could go there then.
Is Bennett Way in a mixed-use zone, are they in the M3 zone? Let's use as an example. What other properties are in the M3 zone? Mm. And the applicant comes before us with any type of other use on a residential property, and because it's, we're defining it as mixed use, just because it's not a single use in that those zones, there's the precedent.
Yeah. I don't think it says under paragraph 7.02b that you have to have, it says in certain instances it is appropriate to have a mix of permitted uses on a single lot. That to me doesn't say that you have to have all permitted uses for a mixed-use development.
A mix of permitted uses.
That says in certain circumstances it's appropriate. That's not a requirement, and it's just a, right, a parenthetical editorial comment.
To, it all comes down to what you classify solar power as. I mean, obviously, this was written without thoughts of solar power.
Without
right,
solar
but then
power.
There's two subsections under B.
Mm.
And it's okay, provided the following conditions are met.
Okay.
That it's permitted in only the four zones. Sorry, five, M4. In other districts where it's specified within the ordinance to allow mixed use.
When
the site
I,
plan review is approved.
It doesn't say that the uses property are permitted. It says that mixed uses are permitted within that zone. I look at it in a broader way than a specific way.
Right,
that to,
a,
that to me doesn't.
Housing, so that this is a residential area.
Mm-hmm.
If there was solar, if it was a residential unit and there were solar panels on it, top of the residential building, would it make any difference?
Yeah, if you're selling
commercial.
It.
This is
difference. Is selling.
This is a commercial
operation.
Well,
those portions used
yeah,
generate.
But honestly, the solar panels on houses are a commercial operation too.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Most
if
of them are
entering
leased.
Into a lease agreement if you own your house, you could enter into the same lease agreement.
Yeah.
And
sell
and I
your
think
power.
That's what we want to be clear on because.
Right.
That is what.
See,
we're
I,
at, that's what we are.
I view it that this is a mixed-use development. And that it's residential, and this new commercial feature has been introduced, and that is indeed mixed use, and that is permitted in that zone under our zoning, and that statement that you're referring to implies that it needs to be of all permitted uses for that zone, but not necessarily. That's not because mixed use is allowed in that zone.
And I think the definition
I think you're
of
reading
that
more
would be
into it than
if someone wants to run a commercial daycare in that zone where they have their residential area and they have a daycare.
Yeah.
Then that's allowed as a mixed use.
Right.
Because both are permitted.
Yeah, but it doesn't say that both of those uses have to be permitted in the zone. And that's how I've always interpreted it. And if you know, that's
I understand Val's concerns.
Well,
it is an interesting question. However, I'm comfortable approving this. You know, we're trying to, as a society, do more. And I understand. Like I said, I understand. You agree with it. I mean, I agree. I agree. But is it who is the code the zoning official in town? You are.
Is there any zoning regulation pertaining to solar?
No.
Right?
So
there isn't.
So you're saying though you're the
I'm
person
that
interprets
that
the zoning
I look at it,
regulations.
This is a mixed use development, which is permit mixed use developments, that broad category are permitted in that zone.
Right.
And therefore it is a permitted
but
use. That's how I would look at it.
As the zoning official.
Yes.
You are saying it is your opinion that this is
right,
appropriate for us to approve this.
Given our zoning that we have in effect right now. I don't see that it says in this paragraph that it has to be a mixture of permitted uses on every instance. It says in some instances, but not in every instance.
Well, I mean, in under normal circumstances or under any circumstance, we would look at the zoning. If Val has a question about the zoning, whether that's appropriate. You've indicated that you're the official that makes that determination. You're saying that it is appropriate.
And if somebody wants to appeal my decision to the ZBA, they're welcome to do so.
So just for clarification, for my own clarification, so as long as we all agree to each individual situation where these mixed-use exceptions are allowed, that would keep, you know, everybody from covering every M3 square foot in Newmarket with solar panels or whatever, you know, so we're going to have to review each of these items?
No, you review each application on its own merits.
If it comes in for site plan.
So we will be judging each application on its own merits.
But I think what Val is, you know, concerned about is that, you know, potentially somebody could come with something else and say, you've allowed this type of development before, you should allow it again.
Right. Setting precedent. We can't come back and say, well, that's not a permitted use on that lot.
Right.
So regardless, therefore, you can't mix those uses because it's not permitted.
There are other replications of other uses.
It doesn't say that the uses on mixed use have to be permitted.
Yeah. I understand that is from an administrative, you know, decision is your interpretation. I do understand that, and I appreciate it.
Okay.
I mean, I think the question obviously shows a hole in our zoning, and I mean, one thing for sure, we don't talk about solar anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a real gap too.
And I mean, anybody in town that has solar on their roof, more than likely, that's a mixed use.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's a commercial enterprise on a residential property.
If you're selling your power.
You're feeding the grid, or if you have a lease for your panels, a lot of them are leases, and you know, you get.
Yep.
So. I understand Val's concerns. I think I'm glad she brought it up. It's worth discussing so we understand going forward, but I'm comfortable with Diane's interpretation and
maybe when we look at the rezoning, that's something we need to address and make sure we tighten that up so we don't have a situation where we have inappropriate uses mixed with residential.
Right.
Sounds reasonable.
Yeah. What's everybody else think?
Just as you're talking about solar, would you include hydro in that as well?
Yeah.
Just if you're going to redo it, and we're looking at different types of industries, right?
I think Diane just had a very good term, appropriate uses.
Yes.
Right. And how do you define that?
Right.
Well,
what's appropriate today is
it
appropriate tomorrow?
It is passive. It's not creating any.
No, but relative to the zoning,
anything
doing an update
else
to the
happening
zoning
on the site.
We
right.
should
it's passive.
Right. Should
there's no moving. There's no moving parts. There's no.
Right. There's no
you
people
know,
coming
access
and going.
Road
there's
constant.
No additional traffic. Mm-hmm. There's no other commercial activity that people are conducting at the site. Mm-hmm. It's a passive activity.
So let me ask you this: so, to your point about traffic, what if they decided that it would be a great idea as to push solar? Even for the electric cars, if they wanted to put one of those electrical outlets, in there, so would that be okay? When if you're talking about traffic flow and it's changing,
as far as I'm concerned, that would be okay because anybody that would be there charging generally
mm-hmm.
is somebody that lives there
mm-hmm.
or somebody that would be there for a baseball game or an event
right?
anyway.
They could be if you go to Red Hook, anybody could just drive up and plug in, go have a beer, and
that's
leave.
Not
right?
true. A lot of places you pay for that.
Well, maybe. I don't know. But I guess, guess what I'm saying, though? If we're looking at this, right? If we're looking at it, I think we just maybe be a little more futuristic to understand what could be attached to it. And I'm only saying that as we go and look at the verbiage, right?
Right.
I got no problem with the service or anything like that, to your point, Val. But just if we're going to look at it, let's make sure that we only have to look at this once.
Oh, I understand. Absolutely. I agree. So what's the pleasure of the board? I'm ready for a motion.
Second your readiness for a motion.
Absolutely.
I think it's a great idea. I like it.
I don't know what the motion is, but somebody want to make a motion.
Let's move forward on this for sure. And we can revisit these minor things in the future. Not all minor things, but somebody make a motion.
We need to take a vote on the waiver first.
Right.
There's one waiver
Absolutely.
Request. The motion to accept it. Somebody make a motion to accept the waiver for the survey?
I'll make a motion to accept the waiver on, I have to name the project, right?
It's on your agenda.
New Hampshire Solar Garden at Newmarket Housing Authority site, the proposed solar panel array. I propose that we accept the waiver for the engineering study for additional, what was it?
Survey. Topography.
Topographic survey.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? All right, now, is there a motion for the project as a whole?
I'd do it if I knew how to phrase it.
Go ahead, take a shot at it. You never learn.
There seems to be a lot of ins and outs on this one. I think I'd prefer someone with a little more experience to make this motion.
I move we approve the Newmarket Housing Authority, Newmarket Town Solar LLC, 34 Gordon Avenue, tax map, U4, Lot 8, M3 zone. With the following conditions, first condition that it be stamped by a licensed surveyor. And the second condition is that sheets 2 and 3 are stamped by a licensed engineer.
Is there a second?
Second that.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed?
Nay.
So one nay. All righty. Thank you, Mr. Keller.
Thank you to the board. Appreciate your time. Have a great night.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Well, there were two nays then.
Oh, say, vote nay.
Two.
I said all in favor, yeah, aye. Said, all those opposed, say nay.
No, no, no. Then make sure you vote.
So you didn't vote yay. Yeah, you're gonna vote nay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I happen to move the bill.
Okay. Next is Gerard Hamel and Eileen Murphy Hamel, public hearing for an application for subdivision at 7 Gonnet Drive, tax map R2, Lot 11A in the R1 zone. The proposal is to subdivide tax map R2, Lot 11A, 11.07 acres with 509.86 feet of frontage into two separate lots. Lot 11A will become 5.69 acres with 292.02 feet of frontage, while the newly created Lot 11C will be 5.38 acres with 210.83 feet of frontage. Good evening, sir. Would you please introduce yourself?
Gerard Hamel.
Jerry Hamel. Okay, great.
I'm on 7 Gonnet Drive.
Is there anything you want to tell us about this?
Creating a new lot, splitting the existing lot right down the middle, pretty much.
Yep.
I guess you've got plans there.
Sure, yep, we do.
I guess I must have met most everything on that. It looks like one waiver request for the contours.
For the back lot.
Yeah, and I don't know if it really shows on the maps that much, but there's quite a wetlands area separating or dividing the lots. So, which really would restrict any building to the street side of that wetlands.
Right, okay. So, before we go too far, Diane,
there is a staff recommendation.
Are you recommending that this be accepted for completeness?
I'm recommending that the application be accepted for technical review because it's substantially complete.
Okay. Everybody had a chance to go through the package? Anybody have any questions or comments on Diane's staff recommendation? And there is a one waiver request.
Yeah, I had a question when I went through it. This is a homeowners association?
Yes, but this lot is exempt.
So you don't need any homeowners approval, homeowners association approval? To
exempt
this.
From all of the covenants, and so, yeah.
So it's not part of the homeowners?
No.
The owner of that lot is not part of the homeowners
right,
association?
Right, or it's assigned. Okay. And we've previously done a subdivision. I had a business, an excavating business, and we subdivided that off of this one particular lot.
Because that land wasn't part of the original Gonic subdivision, other than the land that was...
It was.
No, it was part of it.
It was, and what we had to do, because the covenants wouldn't have worked for us because we had a farm, we had horses and whatnot. So it was a last minute thing, and we excluded lot 11, whatever my lot number is, from any of the provisions of the covenants.
Just from the covenants, not from the.
And it was, but it's part of the, subdivision.
I have the original subdivision plan here, if you want to take a look at it. And lot 11 was part of the original 91 acres, I think.
Yeah, but yeah.
And I did go back and look at the original regulations under which this was developed. And there isn't any stipulation, as there is today, in determining the number of lots based on a density calculation. The only stipulation is that there be almost a third of the land set aside for open space, which in effect there was at the time, and that will continue to be available. Although, as Mr. Hamel pointed out, this lot is not part of that homeowners association, but yet benefits from it as, because it's in the same neighborhood.
So if there's no more questions on the application itself, I'll entertain a motion to accept the application.
I have just a question that, sure. I don't want to belabor the decision-making process, but sure. Just my own curiosity, I'd like to ask you why, with the two wells, when I read the details, that both wells are now on the new subdivided
Peter,
lot.
Peter, hold on. I got to stop right there. We've got to accept the application first before we.
Okay.
Get into technical questions, if you
okay.
would.
So yeah.
I'll make a motion that we accept the application for subdivision at 7 Bonnet Drive, tax map R2, lot 11A and R1 zone, to provide for two separate lots, one being 5.69 acres and the remaining 5.38 acres.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion, comments? All in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay, we've accepted the application. Now, we're on to the public hearing portion of it. So, Peter,
well,
go ahead.
I was just curious as to why the two well locations are now on the one lot, and that what I read was you're getting an easement for the existing well up until the time that that property passes hands, and then that easement evaporates. And now the two well heads are on the one lot, and that existing lot has no well, unless
no, the easement would be put in place for the existing house lot,
right?
Where the house is,
right?
It's one of those wells that people all wish they had. It's a 75 gallon a minute spring,
right?
And it went with the existing Garnet, the original Garnet farm,
right?
And it. I mean, we can't change the location of it, so it's there. When I built, I got the well, and it'll go with the house. I'm not up on the lot numbers.
The existing house is going to be on a lot 11A.
11A.
The new lot is going to be 11C.
So that well will go with lot 11A with an easement.
In perpetuity.
Yes.
Right. And it won't be discontinued.
Was it? I thought I read that wasn't the case, but maybe I'm mistaken. It just seemed odd to me that there was the possibility that you'd end up with a lot without a well at some point in the future.
I think more of the question, do you currently have two wells or just one?
One.
So why, I think more of the question is, why isn't the second proposed well going to reside on the existing house lot? I think that's more the question.
Well, this well is all hooked up to. It's
hooked up
well,
to
one is
house.
Existing,
the house.
Servicing the house.
Yeah,
the
other shows a well radius, a protective well radius for a future house lot. Am I correct on that?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm wrong.
They have to show that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
If the people that purchase my home,
yes,
do not want to use that well, then I would put them in a well on that lot, and I would use that well for the new lot. But right now, I have to show something.
Right. Note 11 on the plan, I think right here, Val, talks about the, upon conveyance of proposed lot 11C, there shall be an easement benefiting the owner of lot 11A for use and maintenance of the existing well situated on proposed lot 11B. which is the existing lot. Then a new well shall be constructed for lot 11C, and a well release easement will be created over lot 11A if deemed necessary, which is what you're getting at. If for some reason they don't want that, then there'll be a new well installed.
Right. Also, this does not trigger state subdivision. Correct?
No, because it's less
correct.
Than
they're
5 acres.
So they're both greater than 5 acres.
Or greater than five yep. acres, sorry.
How do we deal with, because the existing protected well radius goes over to the neighboring property, do you still have to sign a well release?
I believe this. That would be a protective well radius easement or whatever.
Yeah, that would
well,
be.
Onto those,
yes.
Onto the Arquette property.
Yes, that would be part of the septic design approval process.
Okay.
The wells, you have to show
the
wells on that.
And
yes.
The release of the neighbors.
Yes. Yes.
Or not from the neighbor.
Yes.
You're
release.
Taking on any
yes.
responsibility if the neighbor puts their septic there.
Yes. Okay.
The existing well, I believe where it goes onto the Arquette mm-hmm. property. I believe there is a protective well radius in place from when Garnet's on it.
Oh, okay, yeah, this doesn't show that. It shows it ending at the property line, but, oh, maybe not. It shows a protective well radius, but the other
but
is the easement.
But it doesn't show that there's an easement that
yeah, the other, right, because the easement can't go over that property line. So what's the pleasure of the board? Except for easements for the well, seems pretty straightforward. And again, a waiver for the topo for the lot due to the amount of wetlands. That's what the request is.
Mm-hmm. See that the when I looked at this, the map showed a lot 11A and a lot 11C, but. The application said 11A and 11B, and now your note, Diane, says that the tax assessor wants it 11A and 11A1.
That's right.
So we all
he has the final say, and that's just to be consistent
yeah,
with the current
yeah.
So that'll be
methodology that they use.
The plan would have to be amended then to match
right.
that.
Diane, do you feel there's a need that this goes to a TRC?
No. No, it's when I say technical. When I say technical review, that could be by this board, not necessarily by the TRC.
Do you want to take a motion on the waiver?
I will, absolutely.
I move to grant the applicant's waiver request from Section 4.1B1 elevation contours at 2 foot intervals. Applicant has provided necessary information. I think the board needs to deem that appropriate. Sure.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of granting the waiver, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, say nay. The ayes have it. I suppose I need to ask if there's anybody in the audience who would like to speak. Don't all come up at once. No, there isn't, but. All righty, so I guess I'm going to close. The public hearing mm-hmm. at 8:08. Go ahead, Val. You had something?
I think, you know, we have an extensive application. Diane has reviewed this. She's made her recommendations. I think we fully are supportive of that. I don't, unless there's any objection by the board, I don't see any reason to, extend this, to not take action on this tonight.
I agree. Mm-hmm. Sounds like you want to make a motion.
Any more discussion?
Anybody?
No.
Questions? Concerns?
Straightforward. Make a motion to approve the application for a two-lot subdivision at 7 Garnet Drive, tax map R2, lot 11A in the R1 zone. To provide lot 11A, becoming 5.69 acres with 299.2 feet of road frontage, and newly created lot 11BB.
No, it's
no.
C.
With 5.38 acres with 210.83 frontage, subject to the recommendations by the town planner as outlined on the staff recommendation November 18th report, 3 subsections 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say nay. Congratulations, you have another lot.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you for that, Val. All right. While the masses are clearing out, we'll go through new old business. Anybody have any old business? Diane, do you have any old business?
No, I don't.
I don't have any. Does anybody have any new business they want to talk about? Yeah, no new business. Chairman's report. I have nothing to report. Other than I'm looking forward to Thanksgiving. Committee reports. Anybody have any committee meetings? John?
Yep. Conservation Commission was just concerned about the future, the way that the land was going to be managed and the signs, and we're just concerned about that. And you know, we're looking forward, I'm sure, to be involved in this in the future processes.
You're referring to the Hayden family?
Yes, the Hayden family trust area. Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Badger, anything?
Nothing.
Peter?
No.
Jane? Janice? Val?
No, unfortunately, I couldn't make the Economic Development Committee meeting last week, but that is moving forward.
Good. I am meeting with John Connery on Thursday with Steve Fornia to talk about the project and how we might lend some assistance to them.
Excellent. Thank you.
Okay. Diane, planner's report. Don't screw up a good thing.
I don't have anything to report on, Mr. Chairman.
Nothing? Wow.
Okay, I make a motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Great. Thank you, everyone. I hope you all have a happy Thanksgiving.